presentation of making my model of Ontario is the last of the three presentations. In it, I'll describe the initial construction and follow it with changes I made following the discovery of the wreck on the bottom of Lake Ontario. I should point out that there are some slides which are not strictly in chronological sequence, but are used to illustrate a particular result. In addition to that, over the period of time that I've been making the model, I've taken most of the photographs, but others have added to it. And consequently, you'll see photographs with different contrasting renderings of them. When I started this model of Ontario, the wreck remained the continuing subject of wreck hunters, but it remained elusive and the hunt continued. I decided to make an Admiralty style model at a scale of 1:48, that's a quarter of an inch to the foot, and use wood of a different species and shades to paint the model. I obtained a copy of the draft of Ontario held in the National Maritime Museum, then stored in Greenwich. Here's a copy of the draft, which you've seen before. In my enthusiasm for making as accurate a model as possible, and true to the style of models in Greenwich, a study of the draft revealed a major question to me. On the draft, the body plan appears to be larger than the sheer plan, and neither plan is exactly to the size as the given dimensions. The stated length on the gun deck is 80 feet, exactly 20 inches at scale, but the length of the draft is 20 5/8 inches. Several measurements to determine the accuracy of the draft led me to the conclusion that the paper had changed dimensions in both length and width since it had been drawn. These show the differences in the dimensions. And you'll notice that the gallery section is separated, in fact, from the rest of the body plan. I don't know how common that was, but maybe somebody at the end might be able to let me know whether that is a normal method of drawing these drafts. A closer examination showed that the body plan was drawn as being shifted from the hull, and the dimensions of the hull sections were affected only in the same way as those of the sheer plan. A working photocopy of the draft was therefore made to an accurate scale of 96.7% of reduction. And that dotted line that you see there shows where the gallery had been drawn exactly alongside the gallery on the sheer plan, but the body plan had been dropped. And the 3/16 inch measurement there shows the difference in actual length from the calculated length. A working photocopy of the draft was therefore made to this reduction. A good friend still had his frame drawing machine and offered to help with producing accurate frame shapes. This required first making a half model, what to use for the template shapes. I made 17 photocopies of the body plan at 96.7% reduction. And from these, I made templates at the station lines, 9 forward and 7 aft of the dead flat. These adjusted templates allowed me to make a half model, which when fared gave me the accuracy required to make 35 sistered frames. I then used the frame machine to produce frame shapes. And here is a copy, here is a photograph of the frame machine. If you notice, what happens is that first of all, you mount the half model vertically on the wall, as it were. And then this trolley here, this whole section, if I can get there, this four-sided trolley can move up the vertical tracks on these with these nylon wheels that you can see at the back. And the horizontal motion tracks is here, guided by these two nylon wheels. The card for each of the frames was slid into a Z-section styrene frame. Then, moving the pointer against the hull in a vertical direction and pulling it out as you went, the result was the pencil on this end of this horizontal piece would follow the pointer and would then draw an actual frame shape on the card. Then you'd take the card out, put a fresh one in, move the base along to the designed room and space, and continue with the same process. I had given some thought to the scantlings of timbers to be used in the ship. While Ontario had been designed by a British trained shipwright, the building location and availability of timber afforded him unlimited supplies of wood. Ontario would be used as much for carrying freight as for fighting. I therefore set a room and space of 0.315 inches, a purely visual measurement, and omitted the filling frames. This was to indicate the robustness of her construction while allowing internal visibility below the whales to demonstrate the attractive sweeping lines of the conventions of Admiralty style models. Having developed the half frame shapes, I then proceeded to use them to make sisted frames following the Hahn method. This method is well known. I will therefore not describe it any further here, but this is the result. It shows all the frames with the extensions on the framing jig, together with the whales and the gun ports and the row ports in position. I should mention that there were often considerable periods when I was unable to continue with the model, so I made a storage case that could also be used for carrying the model safely. For those who are not quite familiar with this, the case itself is made from half-inch chipboard and internally has strips of half-inch by half-inch mounted just below the top. You could then flip over the model in its frame and in the frame jig so that the model was then the right way up, but suspended on the longitudinal pieces fastened to the inside of the case. I could then put a piece of hardboard right over the top to completely cover the model and hold it in storage to stop the cat getting in there. I noted a note about the wood I would use. The classical wood for these superb Admiralty style models, of course, is boxwood. However, boxwood of the best quality was and remains in short supply, and even Castello boxwood, a good substitute, was difficult to obtain at the time. Fortunately, a friend came to my rescue with a lifetime supply of degamay, also known as lemonwood and lancewood. For modeling purposes, this is almost identical to boxwood, except that it is slightly darker yellow in color. It's similar to boxwood in hardness and stiffness and its ability to keep an edge. And I had more than enough to use for the structural members of the model, including the masts. Its strength and straight grain make it particularly useful for making violin bows. I would use the lighter color of holly for the deck and Swiss pear for other detail work. The inside of the bulwarks, the gun port covers, and the gun carriages would be red acrylic paint, which is sometimes found on models of British ships. I finished the wood with two or three coats of water-based sanding sealer, first sanded with number 200 grit, then with 400, and finished it with 1500 grit where appropriate. The result was to darken the wood slightly and give it a semi-matte finish, which resists casual marking. I had by this time done considerable amount of research into the location of such major items as gun ports, mast locations, crew accommodation, hatch locations, and using reference materials such as Goodwin and Lavery, and inspired by the accounts of model making in Model Shipwright magazine. By this time, I had changed occupations and was able to do research while traveling between client locations. When making the sisted frames, I did not fully comprehend the significance of setting the dimensions of the wood futtock pieces to achieve the sweeping rising lines along the length of classic elegant model hulls. But only the experts would know. And that's where you can see along here, if I use the pointer, you can see the different levels here instead of having the nice sweeping lines. Here we have the hull suspended from the framing jig. The main whale is ebony, a difficult wood to bend even with steaming. And therefore I laminated two lengths of 1/16th of an inch thick to achieve the required total thickness. The radius at the bow here was the limit that I could find even with steaming. I carved a small return under the counter at the stern here, below the drop from solid. I didn't experience the difficulties that some others had experienced in ingraining black dust when sanding ebony, because I had sealed the surface of the frames with sanding sealer before fitting the whale. But in future, if I was to make another of these models, I decided to use another more easily worked wood, such as walnut, and then stain it black. The black strake above the main whale is Swiss pear and the same thickness as the side planking. I fitted a shoe of contrasting coloured walnut cut from a piece of my neighbour's walnut tree, conscious that any coarseness of the grain would not be visible in its thickness and its location. In addition to using carpenter's yellow PVA glue, I pegged all joints with bamboo trunnels drawn down in a jeweler's drill plate to a number 74 drill by 024 diameter, which is equivalent to 1.15 inches at 1/48 scale. I made the gun ports as top and bottomless stubby boxes laid on the side, locating them along the hull as shown in the draft and cutting into the frames where necessary. To ensure the guns were positioned at the correct height on the deck, which has a different shear from the whales, only the front two ports needed to be cut into the whale, just at that section just there. The ironwork was to be brass, which I blackened chemically, and eye bolts are from blackened 15 thou diameter brass wire. If you recall, the video of the discovered wreck showed this at the gallery, and consequently, I constructed the galleries according to the shapes shown on the draft and confirmed on the video, adding windows into all the lights as shown. I first cut the window frames and mullions from holly and laid them over patterns drawn on white line board, setting the vertical radiating lines correctly. The glazing in the galleries is from 22mm by 22mm microscope cover slides, 1/6000th of an inch thick. I stuck these glass pieces onto the frames with white glue. After allowing a day for the glue to cure, I carefully sanded the glass to the shape of the frames with fine grade wet and dry sanding paper, generally used dry. There were numerous broken windows at this stage, but I persevered and eventually produced enough glazed units to finish the galleries completely. Although the glass covered the back of the frames completely, setting the frames into the gallery spaces ensured their future mechanical security. The bow was an interesting challenge to make with its complicated rails and joints that required considerable care in fitting to fade properly against the bow where it caved up and in. And here you see where it curves one way and slightly in another way as the bow curves in two directions. The result, however, shows the main rail here, the eking rail and the gammoning knee, which would then be fitted and produced the head as shown here. It's a congested area requiring to accommodate the grating, the seaman's seats of ease, the inner end of the bowsprit gammoning and the knee of the head rails and the head timbers. While appearing to be decorative, of course, these rails are essential for strengthening the head structure. The bumpkins, which are not shown on here, which you'll see later, are supported from below by iron rods, but the rope shrouds, which secure the bumpkins from side to side, have disappeared over time. A ball-ended dental trim was indispensable in carving the volute head, carving that confirmed the identity of Ontario. The seats of ease are elongated square section tubes. After about a year, I had made a significant progress on the hull, using as much information on structural positions as I could find in the research materials. With the hull mounted in the frame jig and held the right way up in the open carrying case, I could work safely on the gun deck. I fitted the waterway from Swiss Pear, then planked the deck in holly, nibbing the planks into the waterway. I also added Swiss Pear strips on the deck to indicate the location of removable cabin partitions that I imagine would exist. And you can just see them if I get my pointer to work. There's a couple of the strips, which you'll be able to see a bit later. Here's some cabin partitions, which were destined to be added before the top deck put on. And these are Kevel blocks, which I was going to add to the frame into the hull itself. I approached removing the hull from the frame jig with some trepidation, but taking my courage in hand, found the hull was strong enough for me to do this easily using my fine-tooth razor saw. I then trimmed the frame extensions to appropriate lengths of the bulwarks, but I recognized that some of the frames at the quarterdeck would finish at knight heads, but decided I could more easily carve these off the model separately and pin them in place later, because the frames did not actually coincide with the location of these knight heads. Here you can see a couple of knight heads which are pinned to the side of the frames. These two are on top, and this one is let into the side of the frame. Here are the strips that I mentioned before for the cabin partitions. Referring to the Halle method again for the method, I made gratings from Digame, framed them with Swiss pear, and located them according to the positions on the draft. The forward one allows access to the small platforms shown on the draft for stowage of the anchor cable below and for the magazine. I then trim the frame extensions to appropriate lengths at the bulwarks. As a fill-in job, I made the windlass or belfry unit from Digame. I carefully measured the length of the carrick bits, these carrick bits here, long enough to extend from the ultimate deck beams down to the gun deck, and into which I cut mortises to fit the feet. I used short pegs set into the bottom of them to locate and secure them eventually into corresponding holes drilled into the beam below. And here is the windlass located in position with the carrick bits here, and they'll be set into the gun deck below. The bolts holding the bits together are black nails used by railway modellers as spikes to fix track in place. I tapered and six-sided the windlass barrel by hand and drilled holes for the handles, squaring them using a filed nail as a punch to shape the round holes into squares. I cut the barrel in half lengthwise and inserted a short length of the serrated plugs that are used for filling cabinet holes for the ratchet. This then left just the bell, and there we have it in position. And these two standards are located just for the purpose of taking the photograph. Along came Santa Claus with a gift of a small lathe, which is made by Taig and available then at Lee Valley Tools. The better known Sherline lathe commanded enormous prices on the used market at that time, if you could find one. And the new models appeared to have too much plastic in their construction. But I looked on this formidable little machine on my workbench for 3 or 4 months before I overcame my fear of its alarming high-speed revolving chuck. I could have made a master and cast the remaining barrels from it, but I decided to gain experience by practicing on the lathe as being more useful in the long term. In those days, 3D printing had not even been thought of for the amateur. I was able to bore for the trunnions using a milling head attachment and thus produced finished barrels, but I declined to add monograms as being too small to be easily visible. This is a long 6-pounder. This is a standard length 6-pounder. And here's a 4-pounder. And here are two swivels that I made to identical patterns as the major guns. This is a Canadian quarter, which is about an inch in diameter. That'll give you the size of these guns. And this is a short photograph, a small photograph of how I mounted the swivels with the trunnions for demonstration purposes. For your interest, these are 12-pounder cannons present at Fort Niagara to give you an indication that they are the real thing. And these are, in fact, ship's cannons, as opposed to land cannons, which would have a different carriage altogether. This gentleman, of course, is looking a little bit askance, not knowing whether this gun is going to go off at all. There were two long 6-pounders for chase guns in the stern. 14 6-pounders were made for the gun deck, and 6 4-pounders are mounted on the aft deck. This brought the total to the 22 guns shown on the draft. Each barrel is individually made and hence not identical to its neighbor, but only a machinist with a micrometer would be able to detect the differences. Further, I might rationalize that in the days of Ontario, there would be minor differences in dimensions, even when cast by the best of foundries. I decided to add a small deckhouse over the companionway to shield the stairs and the lower deck from harsh weather. This gives you the dimensions of this deck house. A little over 1 by 3/4 inch and 3/4 inch for the height, with iron hinges and handles and a handle for opening the doors. Long cargo items might have been loaded onto the gun deck and below when it was acting as a freighter. So I added a couple of ports in the counter to allow this. And here you can see these two ports. However, I later began to doubt the wisdom of this, knowing of the stresses that pooping waves would deliver. However, they're there and I'm not going to make a change to them. Loading cargo through the main hatch would be obstructed by fixed beams. So initially I fitted these beams with dummy support brackets at each end where they passed under the combing of the hatchway. These would allow these sections of the beams to be removed to permit low cargo loading, but would be tight fitting to give structural strength when supported at the combings with pillars onto the gun deck below. Here's a photo of the hull before removing it from the framing jig. My research initially indicated that historical development of the upper deck would likely result in the forecastle and quarter decks being connected by gangways. So I set the beams and located the combings for the main hatch wide enough to provide gangways 2 feet wide, set by the spacing of the relevant carlings. The combings shown on the drafts started their forward ends on a beam after the windlass and end on the beam immediately forward of the mainmast bits. This would result in a very large hatch, but nevertheless, that's what the draft showed. And here we have all the beams in place with the beams showing the main carlings for the hatchway as shown on the draft. There's a filling carling to be put in there, but at this point I didn't actually add it because the elm tree pumps were to be bolted through onto this. It's the main bits were to be bolted through onto this beam and I needed some working space. The posts for these mainmast bits were made long enough again for the feet to be mortised through the decking and pegged into the beam under the gun deck. I also pinned the bits to the beam just in front of the mainmast and the back of which formed the partners for this mast. This arrangement looked rather strange to me, but their location also shows on the draft this way. Although Ontario would only make short voyages on the lake, I believe there would be a need for hot food for the crew. So I made a basic cooking stove to be mounted on the gun deck in the forecastle. This would reduce the space in the already cramped crew's quarters, but such a facility would be an important feature of the ship. I made the flue removable and would pass through the upper deck for when the stove was in use. And then when the flue was removed, I put a round plate to cover the aperture when under sail. The flue would be stowed against the bulwarks. A photograph later will show you this element. The deck was then planked, omitting several strakes on the forecastle and the quarter decks to allow views of the gun deck below. So here you see the very wide main hatchway with the beams in place. And whilst you may not be able to see it, the small brackets that I put on, supported by posts, were there to support these beams if they were removed to load large parts of the cargo. There's the flue at that point, the bits for the foremast, the cat heads, the elm tree pumps, the companionway cabin, and other deck features. A ship of this size might have been steered by a wheel, but the draft showed the head of the rudder above the poop deck. There was no indication of any structure associated with wheel steering, and I therefore made a simple curved tiller and attached it through a mortise into the rudder head. And there we have this curved tiller. I made a binnacle from Swiss pear and fitted it with a printed compass card and a pair of brass candles for illumination underneath a glazed top. And this completed then the deck furniture. At this stage, the hull was almost complete and I could contemplate the rigging. This photo shows the ultimate curved tiller, and there's the binnacle with its printed card tied down at this point, with apertures in the deck and guns in place. And then it was announced that Ontario had been found. Here's the hull at this stage with masts in place temporarily to give an indication of the size. If you remember on the video, the mainmast has the mainmast, the topmast and the royal are very tall indeed for a ship of this size. Here's the snowmast mounted just behind the mainmast and the jackstaff and one of the anchors. Here's Jim Kennard, a discoverer of Ontario, after doing a lot of research. And here's Dan Scoville, the co-discoverer and the designer of the remote operated vehicle. Here's the main floodlight. And here's two supplementary floodlights, small ones there, the main lens for the camera, and a drive motor for horizontal movement, and a vertical drive motor here, with a fan inserted below this aperture and a corresponding one at the back, so that the ROV could be moved backwards and forwards and up and down. And here's the cable, which eventually would be used and would be linking it to the boat on the surface of the lake. As soon as I heard about the discovery of Ontario, I was in touch with Jim Kennard, and he immediately offered me a seat at the now oversubscribed Discovery Dinner at Fort Niagara. He accepted my offer to bring the model with me. And at the dinner, the 20-minute segment of the full video of the discovery of Ontario that he and Dan had made was shown. I stayed overnight at his house so that he could show me the full 90-minute video and pick up more construction details. I made copious notes to help with modifying the model to achieve greater accuracy. The most noticeable visible differences between the model and the sunken ship were the size of the main hatch, bronze fittings, the anchor billboard, the boarded up gallery window in the captain's cabin, a simple handrail and not a deck house round the companionway, the shape of the tiller, the collapsing ship's boat in the port quarter, and the shifted and jamming guns on the afterdeck. There was rigidly supported bumpkins, and of course, confirmation that Ontario was rigged as a snow. Armed with this information, I retreated to the workshop and, taking out the proverbial chainsaw, removed all the midship decking and the hatchway combings on the model. I reset the hatch combings for a shorter and narrower hatch. There was no longer a requirement to include the suspension system for removable beams. This shows the differences before and after making corrections to the hull. Here we have it originally, before the dinner, before the video, and here we have it afterwards. The principal visual difference, of course, being this main hatch. In it, you'll see that I have three gratings, leaving space for two more, so that you could see down below. In fact, one grating was actually found on the shore the day following the sinking. Here's the billboard. Although it appears to be simple, the billboards were surprisingly tricky additions to construct. They twist outwards from the curving hull as they rise from their bottom edge along the whale to lodge against the fore channel at their upper edge. I fixed horizontal support pieces along the channel and the top of the whale and connected their ends with lengths of timber to make a twisted frame. This supported the slightly over-thickness planking that formed the billboard face. And after trundling boards into position, I carefully sanded the facing boards to scale thickness to show the slight twist. Another feature of the video was the anchor fish set on the starboard foredeck. I made this from a length of degame with recesses cut to secure the fish blocks to be suspended at each end. Two eye bolts were set along the length to take the weight of the fish on a rope sling. A hand rope was set along one side of the fish for manual maneuvering. The inboard end is a loose fit into the span shackle, which is a square iron set into the center line of the deck so that the anchor fish could be slung from each side of the ship as required, the appropriate inboard end then being held into the span shackle. The video revealed the outboard cat head ends were clear of zebra mussels and had a faint, visible circular pattern. These must therefore have been made of bronze. I set a square section brass bar into the forejaw chuck and used a rounded tool to inscribe the concentric circular pattern in its face. I then parted the piece off, leaving a small spigot with which to set the cover plate in position, covering the end grain of the cat head. The snow mast had two bronze cleats at its lower end. I filed these cleats to shape, leaving a small spigot on their base similarly, to allow mechanical fixing into small holes drilled into the mast. Here's the gaff for the snow mast, and these, of course, are the top masts with the trestles for their main mast and foremast. The starboard outer window unit in the stern gallery was revealed to be boarded, had been a solid construction to provide accurate privacy for the use of the officer's head while in port. So I therefore removed the glazed unit, which I showed on the other side at this point. I took the corresponding one out here and boarded it in to completely cover the space. The planking on the ship, on the model, is nominally scaled 11 to 12 inch wide panels, consistent with the availability of plentiful supplies of timber. After cutting these planks from quarter inch thick holly boards, I covered one edge with soft black pencil before laying them to the adjacent planks. When finished sanded smooth, this provides a faint but consistent caulking strip between the planks, resembling real tar caulking on the ship. Planks were glued mechanically and secured with bamboo trunnels that are visual but not too obvious. So this completed the changes made to the original hull construction and results in as near as realistically possible to the full-size vessel. I then started work on the ship's boats. This is the first target that was seen, and therefore I made a 24-foot long boat, a barge or pinnace, using holly, 25-thou thick holly for external planking. The internal planks were twice as thick as this. I made the boats over a plug, as shown under the boats of men of war and the model open boats by Ewart Freeston. I fitted lifting rings, which you can't really see in this one, but you'll see it a bit later, and a rudder operating irons from blackened brass. The oars, enough in number so as not to crowd the display, are leathered over here with brown paper and fit into folds or slots along the gunwales. This will give you an indication of the size of this actual model of the longboat. And here is a model of the 16-foot cutter, which was shown on the video has been collapsing over the side of the boat. Here we have it viewed from above with lifting rings, gratings, and folds let into the gunwales, together with the gratings and ironwork on the rudder steering. And here it is again for size against my mechanical pencil. Two anchors are said to be visible on the wreck. I didn't actually see them on the video, but Jim tells me they were there. And there was the top ring of a third sunk into the mud. I made these from square section brass rod, filed the shanks to a taper, and soldered the arms to them and the flukes in turn to the arms. The stocks are made from two lengths of degamme, filed to taper from the middle to each end, and with the space between used for construction on drying out. The two pieces are trunnelled together, representing bolts, and fitted with blackened brass iron hoops. The rings set into the top there are puddened with cotton. For interest, shortly after I made those anchors, here's an anchor that I saw in Bantry in Ireland to give an indication of the size of some of these anchors. This actually is a recovered anchor from a French 74-gun ship, showing just how massive an anchor could be. So here is now the finished model of the hull, together with the anchors and the ship's boats, ready for me to start into the masting and rigging. After an interval of several years, I began to rig the model. All the masts are pole masts made from degamme, given that sufficient long, straight pine was available at the time in Canada, as so as not to require the made masts required for ships of the Royal Navy. The masts are fitted with hounds and bibs at the head, with trestle trees and cross trees resting on them, which in turn support the tops. Mast caps support the lower ends of the upper masts, which are held in place vertically. And here is a shot of the top mast together with the hounds for the top gallant. Note at that spot. Here's a fid, which is used to ensure that this mast does not drop down through the aperture. And of course, if you wanted to bring that mast down, you'd remove this fid and it would drop down through the aperture within the trestle trees. Here's a photograph of the mainmast head with the top in place. The top is made from 3mm ply, covered in boards and battens, as usual, with battens along here, and with an outer curved rim, which in this case happens to be darker wood. And I left that dark because I knew I was going to stain the whole of this top with alcohol-based black stain. Mortises are cut in here for the straps, for the dead eyes for the upper masts, for the futtock shrouds. Here's another fid. And here's the two tops for each of the masts. I couldn't find any information on how the snow mast is secured at its head. Bear in mind that it just sits on the deck. It would not be fixed rigidly at the top, because movement of the ship would cause the racking, which would overstress any structure which was fixed to the top, and even might even lift the whole mast out. So I constructed a simple saddle, which would be lined with leather and closed with an iron plate as my solution to this difficulty that I had. If anyone can let me know whether this is a Mayer way of doing it, I'd be happy to receive any information. There's the snow mast fitting. Here's the stained black top for the main. These small light-colored pegs are actually the pegs which secure the strops for the blocks, for the bunt lines, leech lines, and brace blocks, which are suspended underneath the main top. Rigging is from very dark brown cotton or cotton polyester blend, quilting thread, made from different denier combinations on my homemade rope walk. I calculated that 7 diameters of rope were required for the rigging. Fly tire silk is used for seizings. And after running up the rope, a small butane torch was run rapidly along the length to remove any fluff, and then pulling the rope against a block of beeswax helped to stiffen it slightly while working with it. In general, I make an initial tie with a clove hitch, which I may finish neatly with a simple hitch or reef knot. Here's another view showing the shrouds. The forward shroud is served from top to bottom, but the next shrouds are shown just served down to this level. Here we have the forestay and the mainstay and the preventer stay fitted with the mouses. And these two are Burton pendants, which are lightly secured with a temporary line to keep them out of the way while I was doing the remainder of the rigging. The Burton pendants are the first ones to be led over the masthead. The mouses, I did consider actually covering them with thread like a darning needle and so forth, but they're so small that after several tries, I just couldn't make them look at all reasonable. So I left them as wood and stained them with dark brown boot polish. Now we have the foremast shrouds at this one, together with the billboard, and details of the gun port covers. Here we see one of the row ports, the chains, the chain well channels, and other parts. And here we have mainmast shrouds, together with the lanyards, which is a lighter color, of course, than the main shrouds themselves. Here we have the bowsprit. They're rigged with two horses. These long thin lines, which are used as safety lines for the crew who will be working along the bowsprit. Here's this has been leathered at this stage, the bees up at the top here, and we have the forestay and the foreventer stay, together with the necessary rigging hearts and the lanyards for them. As you can see, these are not finished off at this stage. We have the bobstays down here, and the shrouds at that point as well. Here we have a different view of them with closed hearts at this point and open hearts fixed to straps through onto the bowsprit. You can see the thumb cleats on the bowsprit, which of course prevent these collars from sliding back down the bulwark towards the hull and therefore can keep them complete and taut. Here's the forestay and preventer stay lead to the bowsprit and adjusted with lanyard at that stage. The mainstay leads to a collar which leads below to the gammoning knee through here, this stage. Just see the collar leading down here through here. And here's the gammoning, which at this stage I found very difficult to thread through because it was so congested. And in order to do that, I first of all led a stiffened piece of very thin line through as a messenger, tied this thicker line through to it, and therefore I was able to pull it through and leaf it through the gammoning and up and over in the classic figure of eight reeving as it went through. This is the bowsprit shroud, which is tied onto the hull through an eye bolt with a hook on the end. And there's a different view with the mainstay going through here. The preventer stay is linked onto the main mast at this point with a couple of thumb cleats to stop that strap from moving. Here's the euphros. I have not yet rigged the euphros, which are the blocks used to spread the crow's feet at the main top and the foretop, but I thought I'd show you those because they're quite small. This one for the forestay is 0.56 of an inch long with six holes, 0.45 of a millimeter diameter, a number 78 drill. And this one for the mainstay showing a 0.62 of an inch long with nine holes of the same size. So now we have a photo of the ship as the model as it stands at the present time, all with the shrouds in place, the stays up, and ready to rig those crow feet. And then 1 month, when I've got 3 years to spare, I could do the rest of the rigging. So here we have a photo of the finished hull done before that, and that's the stage of rigging and finishing on the model hull of HMS Ontario to today's date. So there we are. I hope it illustrates the initial construction of the model and the differences from the model after I'd been able to study the discovery video and made the appropriate connections. I will offer to show a few more at some time in the future after the model is complete.